shops.
I don't want to see what that movie's like.
Well, it's a good thing we brought up Aladdin.
Oh my god, that was really good. Did you do that on purpose?
Possibly, although we might not be live yet.
Oh, hello. Oh, I see us on Twitch. Hello. Hello, Twitch.
Hello.
And
yes.
Hello, YouTube.
There we are on YouTube. Yes, we were just talking about knockoff foreign bootlegs of things because we were discussing Atomic Heart and how it's knockoff foreign bootleg Bioshock.
And we have Bioshock at home.
And then I mentioned like those foreign knockoff versions of Aladdin and The Little Mermaid you tended to see whenever Disney put out their movies. And how appropriate. How appropriate, because Aladdin, for one thing, is on the thumbnail of today's podcast.
Do you think this is the first video you've ever done in your career with Aladdin on the thumbnail?
Well, yes, but that's not extraordinary.
Okay. Do you think this will be the last?
Could well be. Disney's not really my area.
Uh-huh.
Well, you know, my eldest is big into Mickey Mouse at the moment, but...
Oh, maybe Disney is going to become your area.
Well, I guess that remains to be seen.
Be forced on Frozen train, Frozen and Moana train.
You know, these kids are like, they just latch onto something for a while and want nothing else. And then right before their birthday, when you've bought nothing but Mickey Mouse shit, suddenly they decide they're really into Paw Patrol now or whatever. Anyway,
it's all cyclical. I'll come back around.
Anyway, welcome to Slightly Something Else. I'm Yahtzee Crozier. I'm joined by Marty Sleaver.
Hello, everyone.
And with the news that Shinji Mikami is leaving his own company, Tango Gameworks, we thought it would be time to pay tribute to a man who I've long considered one of the great unsung heroes of the video game industry. Certainly one of my favorite creators.
Yeah, same.
Who, despite having an extraordinary resume, I should say, of intellectual properties, just doesn't seem to have gotten the rock star status of someone like Miyamoto or Hideo Kojima.
Yeah, he feels like he's a sort of a step below them, which I guess, to be fair, I feel like most creators are a step below them, though. I feel like his contributions are arguably, Miyamoto aside, maybe as important to the modern gaming landscape as almost anyone.
Hmm. Shinji Mikami started his career making Disney games. That's why Aladdin's there. He made one of the Aladdin 16-bit games. Apparently there were several that were all completely different games.
Yeah, a weird era where like he made the Super Nintendo Aladdin, whereas the Sega Genesis Aladdin was done by an American studio, Shiny, and I believe the handheld ones were done by completely different studios as well. Not sure why that was the case then, but...
God, when was that last the case when sometimes like... a different console's version of a game would just be a completely different game. I want to say the Wii was the last time.
Yeah, because the hardware like couldn't run a normal Call of Duty game, so it would be, you know. Which, I don't know, are we going to get that again? Because Microsoft and Nintendo just released that thing where they said, oh, we're confident in bringing Call of Duty to Nintendo consoles feature complete for the next 10 years. And I'm like, my Switch from 2017 will not run the modern Call of Duty game. I promise you that.
So, if you look at Shinji Mikami's Wikipedia resume, his works list, it's extraordinary because it goes from Who Framed Roger Rabbit in 91, and then Goof Troop and Disney's Aladdin in 93, and then the game after that, Resident Evil.
Yeah.
Which he directed.
Yeah, which it's very strange to go from like you are doing 2D Aladdin on the Super Nintendo to you are creating the rules for an entirely new genre of games in this completely new generation.
Well, everyone knows he ripped off Alone in the Dark, but Alone in the Dark was kind of shitty. So
it was bad. Yeah, I mean it's not who did it first; it's who did it better.
There you go.
Yeah, and it's interesting because he was, Capcom, the Resident Evil story is pretty well known by now that Capcom had a Famicom game called Sweet Home, and he was quite a fan of that, and that had some Resident Evil-ish elements, but was kind of more of a top-down adventure game, horror game. But the reason he ended up going up to bat for Resident Evil was because he kind of didn't like horror things. Like, he tended to get scared very, very easily.
Often these are the best perspectives to bring to an established genre.
Yeah, and so that was why they kind of wanted him to do that, him to almost do the spiritual successor to Sweet Home on the original PlayStation. And again, much like you know, much like Super Mario 64 or Doom or any of these games that we sort of mark as these benchmark games, like they were I mean, he was obviously inspired by Alone in the Dark, but like they were exploring without a candle. Like it was really impressive to put your brain back in that era and think like how these people were like pioneers in being like, I don't know what video games look like in 3D, but here's what I think they might look like. And they kind of nailed it.
It's interesting to hear he didn't really like horror that much, because he certainly does tend to have a specific bent on horror. He usually favors a slightly campy B-movie action sort of horror, sort of like The Evil Dead.
Yeah, he said he was a big fan of stuff like Dawn of the Dead and the old Italian movie Zombie. So you can kind of, you get that feeling. Like, he's one of those original creators where like he kind of wears his inspirations on his sleeve. I think a lot like Kojima, like whereas, you know, Miyamoto's are more like, I liked exploring my backyard when I was a kid.
But the interesting thing to note about Shinji Mikami, and this is probably one of the things that make him one of my favorite creators in gaming, is that he was the director on Resident Evil, but he was only the producer on Resident Evil 2, 3, and most of the ones that followed after that.
Yeah, Code Veronica.
Yeah. And if you look at up and down his whole career, that's basically been the story for everything he's been involved with. And it was the same story with The Evil Within, for example. He directed the first one. He let, what was his name, John Johannes?
Yeah, yep.
John Johannes was the director of Evil Within 2.
Yeah.
And what
and I then take we're going away, to do Hi-Fi Rush.
And yeah. And what I'm taking away from all this is that Shinji Mikami doesn't like making sequels.
No. In fact, I think the only sequel he directed was Resident Evil 4, which
was
feels like such a paradigm shift that
let's get into like the whole resume, because even if you haven't heard of this dude, you've heard of the games he's made. I'm just going down the list here. Resident Evil, Dino Crisis,
yep,
Onimusha. He was executive produced Devil May Cry, Phoenix Wright. He was the general producer on Steel Battalion. He was the director stroke executive producer on everything in the Capcom 5, if you've seen my Capcom 5 video. So PNO3, Beautiful Joe, Killer 7, the one that didn't actually come out, Dead Phoenix, and of course Resident Evil 4, like the one of the most important games in the history of the medium.
Yeah.
And aside from that, when he left Capcom, well, I say left, he started Clover Studio, which was sort of a semi-autonomous spin-off of Capcom, and they produced, and I think part of their, like, the company philosophy was that they didn't want to make sequels, they made new IPs.
They did, yeah, and that didn't last too long.
Which didn't last, but Clover Studio gave us Beautiful Joe and God Hand and Okami. After that, Clover Studio shut down. It was something like Capcom wanted to reabsorb them, and Mikami and other top creatives in Clover didn't really want to go along with that, so Clover Studio shut down. A lot of the talent would go on to produce or go into Platinum Games.
And then he had that Straight Story studio, which was like almost a part of Platinum for a while, which is where we got stuff like God Hand.
We also had Vanquish at one point. I forget who the developer was, and that might have been Platinum. Yeah, that was Platinum.
I think that was Platinum. Yeah, that was part of his kind of Straight Story, which, again, he's worked on a lot of. I think Japanese studios tend to do this a lot, where they have these kind of micro studios inside of studios. Like, the Persona leads are now a part of a team called ReFantasy, which is still inside Atlas, but making their own thing. It's all very strange.
Yeah, well, Shinji Mikami certainly was jobbing a lot, because he also was the creative producer on Shadows of the Damned, which was developed by Suda's company, Grasshopper Manufacture. Then, of course, he started Tango Gameworks, his own company, where they made The Evil Within, The Evil Within 2, Ghostwire Tokyo, and the recent success Hi-Fi Rush. So this guy has a huge thumbprint on the Japanese industry and the industry generally.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, it absolutely stretches outside of just Japanese, especially because of Resident Evil 4. I mean, Resident Evil 4 is arguably as important of a game for games going forward as anything certainly this century. And when you think about it, like, he's been doing this, the Roger Rabbit game was 32 years ago. And so he's been doing this for 32 years, which in the span of the medium of video games, there are very few people who've been doing it as long and as successfully as this. Like, yeah. That 30-year span, you know, you see that a lot, like, actors and directors and musicians and stuff. Like, it's impressive, but you see folks like Spielberg or Scorsese who are, you know, working their medium for like 50 years or so. But in games, we don't have a lot of those people. Folks tend to either burn out, folks tend to fade into obscurity. Maybe they take on sort of higher level jobs that are more sort of overseeing, which he seems like he's done at times, but then he always gets sucked back in to kind of get really hands-on and directorial with his projects.
Well, this is why I have a lot of respect for Mikami, because it's, as an indie developer, I'm just really interested in making games. And he seems to be of the same mindset. He doesn't really want to be a rock star. He doesn't want to, like, have the spotlight. He just wants to make the ideas that interest him. And that's completely how I feel about making games.
Yeah, and it's he's someone who's also just, like, evolved with the times in a really... in a really impressive way. You know, he's someone who started off in the era where colorful 2D mascot platformers were sort of the choice du jour on those consoles.
He was never a Peter Molyneux who, like, needed the restrictions to stop them from doing really stupid things, like pledge to make a huge super game where you can do anything.
Yeah, I mean, all of his games, by and large, you can sort of like map out on a cocktail napkin and understand them all. Like, they all have a very easy, you know, a SWAT team gets stuck in a mansion filled with monsters. Like, these sort of bare bones concepts that are very easy to wrap your head around. And it's just his execution is so forward thinking and incredible, both with the, and we talk about how he never like distinctly directed sequels. He did direct the Resident Evil remake, which is interesting because that felt like one chance for him to sort of be like, I was, you know, the original Resident Evil was kind of, they had to make do with the limitations of hardware and just design philosophy at the time. Whereas by the time 6 or 7 years rolled around, he was able to do remake, both on the you know, a new generation of consoles, as well as just where games as a whole had moved since then. Like, it felt like he was able to be like, okay, this is actually what my vision for that original project was, which is something that Resident Evil keeps coming back to. Like, of all the franchises, that's the one that we keep getting good remakes of. And I guess we'll wait and see a month or so for Resident Evil 4. But
and all this stuff has very strong core gameplay loops as well.
Yeah.
And a lot of very different ones, although there's a couple of like recurring themes, like action horror seems to be something he keeps coming back to.
Yeah.
And I feel like he's got a certain vibe to his stuff that always sort of comes across for me. It's hard to explain. Like I say, it's that sort of slight edge of B-movie campness.
Yeah, and I think even when he's doing, I mean, it's clear that he has games that he's not adverse to sort of to color, to style, to, you know, you look at things either he directed like PN03 or produced like you know, Beautiful Joe and Killer 7 and stuff like that. But even in the scary stuff, I think he knows that an important part of horror is giving the audience a chance to breathe. You have that in the save rooms in the original Resident Evil. You get that in sort of the moments of levity in Resident Evil 4, whether it's, you know, finding the shopkeeper and sort of, and you know, knowing that whenever you see the shopkeeper, you're somewhere safe. Evil Within has the same thing. So it seems like he, like, is a capital D director where he knows how to, like, ebb and flow with the audience's emotions.
Certainly. And, seems to be a variety of different tones he's willing to explore. Because I keep bringing up God Hand, which is actually a very silly, goofy game.
Yes.
Although it has, it still sort of has that sort of punk, violent edge to it. And which Hi-Fi Rush reminded me a lot of for some reason.
Yeah, I feel like that's a lot of people with Hi-Fi Rush, they were almost like, oh, well, this is so weird for a Mikami game. But if you, you know, well, look throughout his...
I guess I might as well stress that that wasn't strictly a Mikami game.
He
executive produced it, but I do get a lot of his, you know, vibe from it.
Yeah, and I mean, part of that is also, I think he's as influential enough to where there's an entire generation of creators who were inspired by him, whether directly trained by him, you know, and working under him, or just inspired by the games he made.
He certainly seems keen to foster the talent under him, which is the sign of a good leader.
Yeah, I think it's knowing that, you know, you're not going to be here forever, and so, yeah, you can, you know, leave your art out, but you can also sort of help the next generation grow, which I really like.
If I was, like, in, like, the directive lead on a game studio, he's exactly the sort of one I'd want to be. I want to make the really weird shit that appeals to me, and then if it makes money, I'll just fob the sequel off to, like, some promising up-and-comer in the star so I can come up with my next weird, crazy idea.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's funny because he's also been a guy who, like, he's had his ups and downs. Like, he...
Oh, sure. There's a fair bit of shit in his resume.
Yeah.
P&O 3 for a start.
Yeah. But he's also talked there's a YouTube series. I'm going to link it in the chats. There's a documentary channel called Archipel, and they do these really amazing polished documentaries mostly on Japanese creators. And right at the start of the pandemic, they did a two-parter on him. And it was really interesting to hear him talk about how when he started working his way up at Capcom and stopped directing, he felt so creatively stifled that he ended up getting depressed. And he got the same thing at Platinum at one point, where he was like, all I was doing was attending meetings, like, and I fucking hated it. And so that's why he eventually left and formed his own company.
It feels like all he was doing at Capcom was making one Resident Evil after another.
Yeah, I mean, it has to be hard when also you make this thing, and then they're like, how many versions of this can we make? How do we make the light gun version of this and turn it into a movie franchise and then make it into an online multiplayer game? And
that's got to be stifling for a creative person. And you can see how he really made the most of his independence once he got out of there.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, he was executive producer on everything in the Capcom 5. Mm-hmm. Which was a broad range. It was a weird phenomenon, the Capcom 5. I did a whole zero punctuation on it once. It was like five games that were pledged to be exclusive to GameCube that were supposed to, like, stimulate the GameCube because it was sort of faltering at that point. And, like, there was, like, that produced three really, really good games, two very shitty ones, with no middle ground. And all the good ones were just ported to PS2 anyway.
Yeah, yeah. Despite him saying that famously joking that if Resident Evil 4 ever went to any console other than GameCube, he would cut his own head off.
Whoops.
Yeah, which that ended up becoming one of the games that's probably on the most consoles of any game of the last 20 years. And then, yeah, after, you know, eventually, over 10 years ago, he formed Tango Gameworks, and they were... I don't know if they were formed under Bethesda or almost immediately acquired by Bethesda and ZeniMax, but they were sort of the Japanese studio in the portfolio of the studio of the company who you know, brings us Half-Life and or not Half-Life, but Elder Scrolls and Fallout. And then 2 years ago, we see that studio gets acquired with all of ZeniMax Studios by Microsoft. And then a couple of years after that, we see him leave. And so we don't know if this was something he had planned. Possibly there was something. I've seen some speculation online that when this acquisition happened, like, senior leadership kind of had to sign something saying that they wouldn't leave for X amount of years. And so, you know, maybe that time is up now, and maybe, you know, they're maybe this is the first of many folks we see leaving, but people don't know. He hasn't announced if this is a retirement or if this is, I want to start a new studio that's not under the leadership of Xbox, or he wants to join another studio, which is a theory I have.
Well, going by his pattern, I don't think I could see him retiring.
Yeah, because I mean, he's not even 60 yet, which, but again, in the games industry, it feels like he's been around literally forever because he's been making 16-bit Disney games.
Man, he does not look 57.
No, right? Yeah, he looks really good.
It's true what they say about Japanese people. They age very gracefully.
Extremely gracefully.
Hugely racist of me to say that.
I don't know. It's a compliment.
Well, it's, compliment, it's positive discrimination, isn't it?
Positive discrimination. There you go. There you go. One of the theories, the one that I subscribe to, is that he might be joining Bokeh Game Studio, which is a relatively new indie studio in Japan, founded by a lot of former Sony developers who left Sony Japan Studio after it sort of shuttered, including Toyama, who was the creator of Silent Hill, and they're working on a horror game called Slitterhead. And so
Ooh.
everyone is sort of and like Mikami's done videos, but with Bokeh Studio and like toured the studio and everything, and a lot of folks are thinking that maybe this is going to be this weird sort of like dream team of the Silent Hill slash Siren creator and then the Resident Evil creator
You
teaming up to
know,
work on some horror.
Marty, as much as I'm admire Shinji Mikami, I don't think his specific vibe that I've talked about works with
Yes.
Silent Hill.
The weird thing about Silent Hill is, unlike Resident Evil, where he sort of benchmarked with 1 and 4, Silent Hill feels like it has different creators every single time. Like,
Well,
I
that well
literally don't even
that's
know who the director of Silent Hill 2 is.
That's absolutely the case. The games were made by Team Silent, and Team Silent was a different bunch of dudes from game to game. And if you played like the four original Japanese Silent Hills, they all had subtly different vibes. I think two and four had the most dudes in common, which is why there's sort of a similar air to those two. I never really liked Silent Hill 3 that much. That was the one that was trying to be a direct sequel to Silent Hill 1, and it felt a bit mired in the established plot. I preferred the the fresher sort of horror anthology take that 2 and 4 did.
Where do you so 2 and 4 of those original Silent Hill games, well, probably of all the Silent Hill games, those are your favorite. But
Yes.
aside from 4 of in Resident Evil, obviously 4 I would say is your favorite,
Yes.
right? Aside from that, which are your standouts, whether Mikami worked on them or not?
Well, I never really got into the Resident Evil series up until Resident Evil 4. I had to be persuaded to give it a go. I
Like when
guess
it came, you played it when it came out, or did you come to it late?
when it came out,
Okay.
because like someone got it and then said, "You have to play this. It's like the shape of things to come." So I played it and absolutely loved it, though I never liked the original fixed camera stuff. So, I've quite liked a few of the Resident Evils that came after that just because they were more like Resident Evil 4. I quite liked Resident Evil Revelations on the DS.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, those ones, again, Resident Evil is such a weird franchise just because of how much they've thrown at the wall. And some of it's really stuck and just some of it absolutely hasn't. But I think there's very few franchises over the past 25 years or so that have sort of tried as much in as many different venues as Resident Evil has. It's kind of like a it's a very strange, like the ups and downs that franchise has had. And after Resident Evil 6, thinking like, is this done? And then coming back with Resident Evil 7.
There's a lot of Resident Evil movies. I mean, leaving aside the live action ones, there's like apparently there's like a ton of CG animated ones that
Yeah,
I
there's
haven't
one just
seen.
coming out now, and they're all canonical, and people are like, oh, Jill's back. And I'm like, what is happening here? Like, who are these movies for? Like, are they for the hardcore fans of the series?
See, I absolutely wouldn't want to touch those with 10-foot barge pole because I've always felt Resident Evil has only really worked when it has made the effort to get away from its extensive established plot.
Yeah, I feel like lore is the downfall. I think like a burden of lore is the downfall of a lot of storytelling, of thinking like, oh, make sure you've done your homework with 35 things before you enter here. There's a kind of a heavy weight to a lot of like the MCU stuff, even with that now.
That's also why I don't read superhero comics.
It seems like there's a lot of homework you have to do before you sign up. Whereas, his Resident Evil games, like Resident Evil 4, obviously Leon and Ada are sort of pulled directly from 2, but you don't really need to know that, and the game doesn't even really it introduces Krauser, and you'd be like, oh, that guy's definitely from an earlier game, right? And you're like, no,
No, he's not.
he is not.
It's just, it's basically, it just cuts away all the chaff, and it's just about rescue the president's daughter from evil cop. Resident Evil 7 does something similar. It's like, forget about all the established shit. It's just rescue your wife from the evil cult.
And then the last 20 seconds, it's like, here's Chris. Chris is back. You
Yeah,
all love Chris.
that's where I sort of went, because bringing Chris back is always the bad sign in Resident Evil.
It's also with the Resident Evil sort of movies and extended universe, it's you get to one of those points where I'm like, why wouldn't I just watch the better movies that inspired Resident Evil? Like, there's much better, zombie fiction to watch in movie form. Whereas in game form, I would say Resident Evil is among the top of the many, many, the heaping pile of zombie fiction.
Well, if Mikami's getting together with the Silent Hill dudes, let's hope Mikami focuses on the gameplay and the Silent Hill dudes do all the story work.
There you go. That sounds
That's
like
all I can say.
a nice combo. Yeah, we don't know though. Like I, given his track record, I could see him. I don't see him like joining a massive established company. I don't see him joining like Sony or anything like that, or rejoining Capcom. Although I don't know. Do you think there's like a certain amount of money Capcom could have offered him to be like, come back and make another Resident Evil, and he would do
Well,
it? Like,
that doesn't seem to be his motivation, as we've discussed. I mean, the pattern just
no.
keeps recurring. He keeps starting new studios the moment the big corporate dudes start getting their fingers in it.
Yeah, which is interesting because that's we get that a lot from Japanese developers. I mean, from American creators, Western creators as well. But like, I feel like I think we were talking about last week on one of the streams. Sort of the I don't like the term rock star developer, but like the developer where people know them by their name, not just by the studio, but like
Well,
know the creators by their name.
we as video game insiders know his name. I wonder how well known
Yeah.
he'd be in more casual circles.
Yeah, that's a good point. And I guess this audience probably would know Mikami's name just because if they've listened to us talk, we've probably mentioned it a bunch. But it feels like I can, like off the top of my head, I feel like I can name a lot more Japanese directors than I can Western
Well, the
directors.
Japanese industry has always been more focused on the auteur director as a figure in the game development thing. But they
Yeah.
take more the approach that like Western movies do, where you have one director who's puts their particular character on their work,
Yeah.
even though it's a huge team effort. Whereas Western video games tend to de-emphasize individual names, especially in the modern industry.
Yeah, like outside of very small indie games, I mean, one person indie games generally, because even if it's a team, usually the director doesn't like to be singled out. Yeah, why do you think that was with Japanese games? Do you think that was
I don't
like
know.
why
So,
did folks like Kojima and Inafune and Igarashi and Suzuki and all that sort
I
of
mean,
bubble
it's
up?
hard to say this without sounding like a huge weeb, but it's often felt like that the Japanese industry is generally slightly more mature and developed than it is in the West. Like they've already gone through all kinds of weird experimental shit that the Western industry came to much later. Like well, it's I loathe as I am to like tar the entire Western industry with the same brush, but Japanese companies were making like the light farming sims for decades before shit like Stardew Valley got popular in the West.
Yeah, it's funny. You've talked about cozy games. It feels like those originated in Japan. Although you could say almost most genres originate in Japan, right?
Yeah,
Like
but
if only because they were at it first.
and there's piles and piles of niche games that made in Japan that don't make it outside the country. And they've already been through all the like gameplay experimentation shit.
The one rare thing we don't get is the sort of the solo indie projects from Japanese
Well, the original
developers as much.
solo the original solo indie blockbuster was Cave Story,
Game story. Yeah, I guess that's a good point.
which was by a Japanese developer. It was by Pixel.
And that's kind of like the that's like the first, that's before Meat Boy and everything. That's like the first kind of one man band indie project.
That was like the, I'm not sure what you'd even call it, like the pioneer of PC indie gaming.
And then that was like well before kind of the wave of Xbox Live Arcade and everything sort of started making that more the norm.
When was Cave Story? I want to say 04 was when Cave Story came out.
That sounds right.
So like
Yeah, 04.
3 years before ZP started, before
Jeez.
Steam was a thing, I think. Well,
Yeah, and well before
before
like
Steam was a
Xbox
huge
Live
indie platform,
Arcade.
Cave Story was like released freeware on like just some random website. That was way before there was like all this established infrastructure for this kind of thing.
Yeah, I love that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's I don't know. Like, I guess before going to comments, like just putting a bow on it. Like, I following single creators throughout their careers, especially as someone who's bounced between, you know, working his way up at one of the biggest developers in the world, and then sort of pivoting from that into something smaller, and then creating his own studio. Like, it's really like a fascinating ride to watch and to see that he's still been able to kind of put his thumbprint almost at least one game per generation to release something that's either hugely influential at large, or something like, you know, your God Hands that become like a really like cult, develop yes. a really cult following. Yeah.
Like Killer 7 as well, funnily enough.
Yeah. Killer 7, Vanquish. There's a lot of games of that era that, I don't know, like, what are those? Do we get those games anymore? Like, what?
Cult hits?
What are the current equivalents of that? Or can you not know until you're a ways removed from it?
Well, I guess some people are going to be saying that Hi-Fi Rush is a cult hit.
Yeah.
Although I guess it's a little more mainstream than that. I guess.
Yeah, it just seems like it's like universally loved. Like, I was thinking of that Wanted Dead game, if that's ever going to get like a critical reappraisal and people are going to be like, actually, this was genius. KC was right.
Well, I hope this gives you a little insight. All you kids who like came into Hi-Fi Rush saying, gosh, this is an unprecedented thing. Mm-hmm. This suddenly amazing, new, innovative cult hit suddenly coming out of nowhere from the corporate sector. Well, hopefully this gives you a little more context that this is basically Shinji Mikami's entire career.
Yeah, it's kind of been his MO. If you look at PNO3, that is a game where that is not nearly as successful as Hi-Fi Rush, but that is a game where the main character, their idle animation during combat is kind of tapping their foot to the beat of music.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what you see in Hi-Fi Rush. So,
and
so
as I keep saying, it looked more like she was busting for a piss.
did it look like Chai was busted for a piss, or was he?
Well, no, because he was snapping his fingers as well. There was that added bit of visual flair that made you realize he was supposed to be like grooving to a beat, and not that he was just about to piss his pants.
Anyway. That happens when you have too much Chai. Yeah.
All right, super chat time.
Lovely. I'll start on Prime. Can I start on Prime first? Because we've got a Prime resub.
Oh, okay.
Over on Switch. True Mandalorian, thank you so much. Resubbing on Prime for 6 months. 6 months of fantastic ad-free wonders. Hashtag MogWorld2. Is that a real hashtag? Are people using hashtag MogWorld2?
Well, it's the first time hearing of it.
Okay, hashtag MogWorld2.
Probably is not going to be a MogWorld2.
Oh no. What if enough people hashtag it, though?
Then there'll be even less likely to be a MogWorld2.
Oh no!
Because I will feel too pressured. Gary Davis gives £2. Says, do you have any thoughts on Star Trek Resurgence? My thought is, blimey, I've never heard those three words put together in that particular order before.
I believe Star Trek Resurgence is a Telltale-esque story-heavy adventure game coming out in April.
Well, it's one of the less common sequel RE words, just to stick on the end of a
title.
That's
true. Star Trek Revengeance. And I think it's like a direct follow-up to one of the shows, either Next Generation or...
Oh, well, who the fuck knows?
Deep Space Nine.
Like 15 shows now.
There's a lot of shows. There's too many shows.
Anyway, High Sco gives £4.99, says, unrelated but mentioned from last week, just confirmed today, Stephen Fry is going to be the host of the upcoming UK version of Jeopardy later this year. I don't care, High Sco.
But you love Stephen Fry. He's British. Is he British? He's British. There you go.
It's about as British as they get, frankly.
Yeah.
Jeopardy with, like, just members of the public answering questions? It's not like a celebrity panel show? Sounds boring to me.
You don't want to see regulars? Old regulars answering questions?
Who cares? Kiro06 the 13th gives $2 and says, thanks for the subtitles on the Escapist videos. You're welcome.
You're very welcome. A lot of that is done by Will. Will C. Blogs. Will Cruz.
Thanks, Will.
Well done, Will.
Where there's a will, there's a way.
That should be a new video series. I don't know what it is, but he could do that.
Yeah.
I'm sure someone already has that video series.
Start with the title. That's all you need.
Did you have working titles for Zero Punctuation beforehand?
Well, we tossed a few ideas around. I mean, I think we considered Punctuation Zero as well as Zero Punctuation.
Like, were you intent on punctuation being in it?
Well, we wanted to emphasize the fast talking thing. I threw out the Yellow Room as a possibility.
The Yellow Room? That just sounds somewhere like someone pisses a punch, though.
Yeah, it sounds like, or possibly something like obscure Eastern European art film.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Although you shouldn't worry too much about the titles of things. Most people will just accept them after a while.
There you go.
Orbiting Peanut gave us $5 and says, wanted to say thanks to the Escapist for making me feel less like a baby gamer for playing Hi-Fi Rush on easy. Can't follow a beat, but loving the game. Yeah, that's the trouble with rhythm action games. Some people just can't. Some people just don't really have any natural rhythm.
Yeah. No, I promise. There's some corners of the internet might shame you for putting a game on easy. This is not one of those corners. If I'm here, I'm always going to tell you put the game on easy. Fucking whatever gets it out of your life quicker. Well, even Nick, who's so good at games, played
Death Stranding. Well, Nick would certainly say that if he was recommending Death Stranding, yes.
There you go.
M. Morris Wood gave us £20. Boy, that's like $100 American.
Thank you so much.
And said, just wanted to pop a super chat on my train home from work to say thank you both for being my COD podcast during 3 scary months of unemployment. COD? Call of Duty?
Call of Duty?
Well, the entertainment and intellectual distraction were greatly appreciated. What else could COD stand for, Chad?
I just ended up going to a Wikipedia page of Cod Le Fish. Which I don't know. How did I get there? I don't know. I think people think he meant possibly EOD, end of day. No, he said he was on unemployment, though. We're on unemployment. You don't have any.
Maybe he just spends his whole day masturbating furiously and then likes to unwind in the evening.
Yeah, same thing. Or maybe Call of Duty, like maybe he listens to, maybe they listen to Call of Duty or to our podcast.
Maybe they play Call of Duty while listening to a podcast. Okay.
Like you have podcast games, so maybe Call of Duty is a podcast game.
That makes more sense. Although I wouldn't want to play like a multiplayer Call of Duty because you probably wouldn't hear people sneaking up on you if you were listening to a podcast the whole time.
That's true.
Anyway, Jackson Jewel gives $2, says, did you ever watch the Resident Evil movies? Well, I did, as a matter of fact, watch the first two Resident Evil movies because I was writing an article for Australia's Hyper magazine on video game adaptations of films, which weren't quite completely overdone at that time.
Yeah.
When would this would have been? It would have been like 2005, 2006.
Early on. Oh, okay. You didn't do the first one, because the first one came out when I was like 2001, I think, like when I was in high school.
Yeah. Those movies were kind of shit.
Yeah. I think, if I'm not mistaken, Mikami was like had some small role on the first one and was like kind of had some script notes or something, but then very quickly wanted to distance himself from it.
Yeah. Well, there's no mention of that in his works list, although it does mention that he did a voice in Fallout 4.
Oh.
Apparently he was the Japanese voice of Takahashi. I have no idea who Takahashi is.
It sounds like someone who should have a Japanese voice, though, so that's probably good.
Sure.
Interesting. Anyway. One note is in that documentary, it films a lot of him just kind of like wandering around Tokyo. And let me say, he drives a very nice car. I don't know anything about cars. It is a very fancy car. So maybe he got paid a lot of money from that Resident Evil movie, for him.
Well, he invented Resident Evil. He could probably like name his price these days.
I mean, if every time Resident Evil 4 is ported to a new console, he gets to cash a check. Yeah. I wonder what kind of a deal he has with this Resident Evil remake. With these remakes, like even like Resident Evil 2, like he produced Resident Evil 2 and 3, like is he making money off those remakes?
Well, we gotta hope so.
Oh yeah, I would like to think so.
So at least get some residuals for that.
Oh, apparently Takahashi is the robot ramen chef, says Kamja Ninja in the game. Look at that, a lot of people knew that. Oh my god, you guys are so smart.
The True Mandalorian gives $2 and says, Mila Jovovich deserves an Oscar for all RE film. Well, I you might have trouble taking that case to the Academy, the true Mandalorian.
Possibly. The only thing, again, if you want to say someone who has a sweet deal, her husband, Paul W.S. Anderson, directs all those movies.
Yeah, was the director.
So that's just great. That's just two paychecks.
That's like the only reason she was cast in all those films. Yeah,
it's great. It's great. Good for them.
Heisco comes back with 199 and says, will the funding goal feature Mikami's works? Well, it might as well.
That's a great...
You might notice we're funding Amy and Frost getting to play a bunch of retro Disney games that they're into.
I feel like the Aladdin Super Nintendo, that's a good one. They talked about possibly playing the Lion King. I'm trying to shy them away from it because hot damn, that Lion King game is hard. It is so fucking hard.
Which one?
They were, weirdly enough, Lion King, which came out like a year after, or maybe even a year before these Aladdin ones, same game on both consoles. Exact same game.
Hmm.
And then, but Aladdin had the two different ones. Yeah, I don't know what the deal with that was. Very weird.
John Connor gives $5 Canadian and says, are there certain game mechanics or gameplay loops that you'd like to see big games be inspired by from Mikami games? Mine is Vanquish's sliding.
Ooh.
Might enjoy High on Life if you liked the sliding in Vanquish. It has a very similar mechanic.
Yeah. What, I mean, even Wanted Dead has sliding, but that's a very janky version. Yeah, the sliding in Vanquish feels so good. Like, Vanquish, you could see stuff like, it only came out a few years later, but Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, inspired by that. Yeah, Vanquish is one of the best feeling third-person shooters I think I ever made.
Well, the one I keep thinking of is God Hand and its build-your-own-combo feature. I thought that was a really unique and interesting mechanic that I'm surprised no other game took up. The only other game that tried something like that is Remember Me, and it was and it was very shallow.
It feels like one of those mechanics that would have become ubiquitous like 10 years later, but still hasn't.
Yeah, like time loops in Majora's Mask, and somehow no other game did time loops for like 20 years, and then they became
and
really
then now
hot.
Now every game.
Combos, I want to say you could almost see something like that in Indivisible, which was that game by the Skullgirls devs where
you had four
characters in the party and you'd like combine their moves in a manner similar to a fighting game by pressing the button associated with each party member in sequence.
Yeah. I remember that game existing. I never played that game. Well, yeah. It's kind of hard.
Story wasn't very good.
No, that's what I heard. Yeah, it's funny. It's funny to for John to ask sort of the forgotten mechanics of or the less celebrated mechanics, because if you wanted to make a list of like Resident Evil 4 just sort of went down the list, and like every game after that took so many ideas from Resident Evil 4. I still love the way the Resident Evil, especially Resident Evil 4, handles inventory. I like that the inventory itself becomes a little meta game, like a little Tetris game. It sort of scratches a nice like OCD organizing itch if you have it in the same way something like Unpacking did.
Doesn't it just?
Yeah. There's like a whole indie game someone made, I think like last year, that was just inventory management.
I was about to bring that up.
Yeah. And I don't know what you do in that game though.
And I've been playing Dredge a bit, which has a very similar mechanic for arranging equipment and fish around your ship's hold.
Oh, I like it. Yeah, and I'm glad Capcom didn't seem to like, they didn't fucking like copyright that, like the Nemesis system or any nonsense like that. Good on you, Capcom.
Ludwig Williams gives $9.99 and says, Yahtzee, in your post-CP stream for the Forgotten City, you say the only way to get into Malleolus's villa is to jump after Ulpius, but you can also turn the vines to gold and climb them. I apologize, Ludwig Williams, for not reading out your super chat with a very dorky voice, which it clearly deserved, you massive pedant.
If Nick wants to do this, we should remove the ZP for Forgotten City, even the regular ZP, not just the post CP, and then you should have to redo it and make sure that you let people know that Maleficent's villa can get vines on it.
No, I think we should take the Forgotten City ZP off altogether and the stream and just put up a big sign saying, we took this down because Ludwig Williams wasn't happy. Please address your concerns to Ludwig Williams.
Was Forgotten City a time loop game?
Yeah, it's one of the good ones.
I didn't play it. I didn't play it. Or I played like 10 minutes of it. I thought it was kind of ugly.
I want to say it's one of my favorite time loop games.
It got very good reviews. People really liked it.
Yeah, I really liked it.
And it's kind of like a mystery, like a murder mystery, right?
Yeah, I stress I liked it because it's a very well-written game. You might not like it if you like things like spectacular graphics and shit.
No, I like good words. I like people who do the words good.
It looks like what it is, a glorified Skyrim fan quest.
Yeah.
Watch
Damien, I
Tech.
haven't forgotten Forgotten City. I just didn't play it. I didn't forget it.
Watch Tech gives $10 and says, nothing to add, just showing support. Well, you did forget to play Forgotten City, apparently.
I think I chose not to play it. I think
Okay.
it was part of I refuse to play games that don't have the most graphics. I
Well,
only play games with all the graphics.
so you forgot it in the sense of, hey, forget about it, my man.
Yeah, there you go.
Move on. Bag of Dicks, member for 9 months in early access, says, hey, Marty, are you going to try RE4 in VR?
Hell yeah. Probably not. No. I mean, maybe. I don't have a VR headset. I don't know.
I have played RE4 on my Oculus, on my Quest 2. It's fun, if a bit, piss easy, considering that RE4 was sort of built around its slightly awkward controls.
Yeah. They also announced that Resident Evil 4 Remake is coming to PSVR 2 as well. I don't know. Horror in VR seems like too much. The thing I want VR is I want VR to just give me nice chill vibes. I want to go to a nice cool place and I want to hang out and maybe do some puzzles. I don't once
Well,
like the scaries start coming at me, I don't want to do that in VR.
a lot of
Get the scaries out of here.
people like the adrenaline of the scary experience, and
Yeah, no. I'm just saying it's not for me.
it's much enhanced in VR.
Too much. It's too scary. Get those fucking those Los Illuminados or whatever those dudes are. Get out of there. I don't want that.
Look,
Oh, when their fucking heads explode. Oh man, regenerators in VR. Get
oh,
out of here.
blimey. Ludwig Williams comes crawling back with another $1.99. I'll remember to use the dorky voice this time, Ludwig, and asks, do you have a Steam Deck?
Well, that's
No,
a
I
normal
don't.
question. That's just a regular question.
Yes, well, I realized he was a huge dork from his last super chat, so I've, preemptively put it in there. No, I don't, Ludwig
I believe
Williams.
Nick is the only, well, and Jack, they both have Steam
Yeah,
Decks.
they're hoarding their
And
Steam Decks. What a pair of assholes.
I think the plan might be to get Amy a Steam Deck for when she's in the States, because apparently it's still very hard to get in Australia or something like that.
Well, she'll still have to download games for it. That'll be hard.
Oh no! Dun dun dun!
With Australian internet being
Oh
what it is.
no! Oh no!
Wesley Thomas gives $5 and says, sorry, I missed it last week. I was at the doctor. Here's some money towards the stretch goal, whatever it is this time.
I
It's
like that
Disney games,
you
Wesley Thomas.
apologized for not giving us money when you were at a doctor. Wesley, I hope your doctor appointment went very well.
I don't. I hope it hurt.
If I hope they realized that your ass was cracked and then they got you a new one. That was an ass crack joke.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it's supposed to be cracked. Did they fill it in? They shouldn't have
Oh
done that.
no. Your ass got caulked? Don't caulk that crack. I shouldn't have said any of that. I don't like any of that. I regret most of this.
Christopher Marion gives $10 and says, Yahtzee, you're a gentleman and a scholar. Well, I'm at least one of those.
Where did that
Or
phrase come from?
perhaps even neither of those.
Where did that phrase come from?
I
So we
don't
talked
know.
last week about where we thought the whole friends we made along the way, maybe it came from Stand By Me. Gentleman and a scholar, where did this come from? Everyone uses this phrase. What's going
Gentleman
on
and
here?
the Scholar origin. I'm Googling that now.
Oh, hell yeah.
The term dates from the days when only well-born boys and men received any education at all. Its earliest appearance in print was in George Peel's Merry Conceited Jest of 1607. He goes directly to the mayor, tells him he was a scholar and a gentleman.
Then why do we flip him around? Why can't you be a scholar and a gentleman? What's going on here?
Who the hell knows?
Also, I wasn't gonna well actually you on pronunciation of something earlier because I was afraid you were gonna make fun of me in the dork voice. But Wojtek was one of the people, Wojtek, and I know it's pronounced Wojtek because there's a famous bear during World War II. The Polish army liberated a or there was a zoo that was abandoned or a circus, and they ended up meeting this bear. And this is a true story. This big old brown bear. And he just befriended this like troop of Polish soldiers, and he would smoke cigarettes with them and dance and shit. And he would like carry ammo for them. And it's incredible. And I don't know why we don't have a movie about Wojtek the bear, who's just a cigarette smoking, Nazi hunting bear. We got this fucking cocaine bear. Yeah. We don't need that movie. We need Wojtek the bear.
Like, people are more interested in the cocaine bears, it seems.
Why? This dude carried ammo. He smoked cigarettes. He fought Nazis. Oh, my God.
Bears don't have the immediate appeal of, like, a dog.
Yeah, but I mean, dogs fight Nazis.
There's always a faint suspicion hanging around bears, because there have been many documented cases that they'll have a bear who's, like, friendly as pie their entire lives, but then one day they just turn on someone and then no one really knows why.
Fucking Wojtek wouldn't do that. Only person he ever turned on was fucking Hitler and tore his face off.
Well,
yeah, there's a Wojtek statue in Edinburgh.
I mean, what if Wojtek felt like tearing off another face and there wasn't a convenient Hitler around?
He wouldn't, though, as long as you give him enough smokes, he'd be fine. During the Battle of Monte Cassino in Italy in 1944, Wojtek helped move crates of ammunition and became a celebrity with visiting Allied generals and statesmen. How cool is that?
I feel like getting a bear hooked on nicotine isn't the wholesome story you seem to think it is.
Could you imagine the nicotine withdrawal that bear had?
I mean, there's a lot of science labs where they do that to like small bunny rabbits, and most people consider that a rather upsetting practice.
That's true. Wojtek died at the age of 21, and I don't know if that's old or young for bears.
Oh, who can say? It's like as a general rule, the larger the animal, the more likely it will have a longer lifespan.
Wow, those big old turtles lived like 700.
What kind of bear was he? That probably would help.
Bears only live 20 to 30 years. I believe he was Wojtek the bear. A Syrian brown bear. I don't know why Syrian, but brown bear. Yeah.
Well, there you go.
Good on him.
Mark Maynard gives €5 and says, just saying thanks for the content over the years.
Thank you.
You're welcome, Mark Maynard. Thanks for the money.
Yeah.
John Connor gives $10 Canadian, says, finished suffering through the shimmy protocol. Do you think we'll ever see a game with a bigger shimmy to gameplay ratio? Played at a friend's house, so no money to them. Well, a lot of games seem to be competing for that title. God of War Ragnarok had a pretty high shimmy index. Guardians of the Galaxy was full of the old shimmy-in.
Yeah. Don't say it's shimmy-in. I don't like that.
I was impressed by how relatively little shimmying there was in... What's that recent game I was playing?
Dead Space, Forspoken.
Oh, the Dead Space remake.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was, I think, new gen only. Dead Space remake. Yes, new gen only. Whereas stuff like God of War Ragnarok was still on PS4. And so you can't just be like, well, the hardware makes you shimmy faster through the thing. Right. Like, you just gotta, I guess, keep that in there. Hoping like the era of shimmying is slowly behind us as we get more and more new gen games.
As we get more consoles with solid state drives.
Yeah.
And short loading times. Stephen Brown gives $5. Just picked up some Toffee-tastic Girl Scout cookies. So here's $5 for the other toffee.
Aww.
Here he is. He likes cookies too. You have that in common.
Incredible.
Not in cookies with himself in them. That sounds traumatic. Look at that noble face. You wouldn't think he hung around a baby's high chair hoping to catch errant crusts. Simple Simon gives $20 and says, question, ChatGPT, give me a question to ask the creator of Zero Punctuation that is very obscure and under 200 characters. Answer, what was the inspiration behind the color palette of the characters in your game Trilby's Notes? Oh, well, thank you for your AI-generated question, Simple Simon. They were colors that worked.
What's your favorite color?
Well, the main character mainly wore blacks, whites, and greys, which are sort of evergreen.
Yeah. Always in style.
Yeah. And one of the characters had red hair because they were Irish.
Mm. Yeah. I've seen some red-haired Irish people in my time.
I think that's all the thought that went into it, frankly.
Yeah.
Oh, and the
what was the, what was the deal with this game, Trilby's Notes? Was it an adventure game?
Yeah. From my Chizuru Mythos series. Oh, and there was a big villain who wore a big black coat because big black coats are scary.
They are scary. You also don't know, like, are they going to, like, they're wearing pants under that? Or are they going to flash you like some sort of a deviant at the mall?
Well, quite.
Yeah.
No, I don't. Worry about. No, I do not still own a Trilby, Kamja Ninja. I do own a Stetson.
These are all different brands of hats? Types of hats?
Yes. I wear my Stetson on sunny days.
Oh, that's nice. Are they different than fedoras?
Well, yes. Trilby is a, Trilby is sort of a kind of fedora, so with a slightly smaller brim.
What kind of a hat does Indiana Jones wear?
He wears a fedora.
Okay. Because he looks very cool.
Hmm. Donald Nabaty gives a whole $50. That's a lot. Deep red super chat. To say, trying to get this in before the stream ends. Hope y'all are doing well.
You did incredibly well getting it in before the stream ends. Just like Indiana Jones when he tried to grab his hat when that door was closing.
How very timely.
Yeah. Also, Indiana Jones should have met Wojtek the Bear along his journeys. The two of them fight Nazis? Oh, they would have had a great time.
Maybe he did. Did you watch the whole Young Indiana Jones Chronicles?
I did not. I did not. So that one might be on me.
Oh, wait. He was an adult in the Second World War, wasn't he?
It doesn't matter. They don't know. He's, yeah, he's like 10,000 years old. It's fine.
Well, that's not too old to bring out a new one, apparently.
Okay, he's so old. Let him sleep. Let the man sleep. Let him crash his planes in peace.
I think they're just CGing him young again, as I understand.
They are for the cold open. They are. Yeah. I think he's still going to look old. I mean, every stunt I'm imagining is not him, but that's fine.
Does anyone want to see Toffee's scary fangs?
Oh, no. Why are they scary? Ooh,
look at those scary fangs. Look, nice, friendly, sleepy dog. Nice, friendly, sleepy. Nice, friendly, sleepy. That's how easily they turn on you. Like Wojtek the Bear.
Oh, no. Wojtek would never do that.
Well, that's it for Super Chats. Not so many this week. Guess this topic wasn't much of a draw, but never mind. It was something we were interested in.
This was one for us.
Yeah.
You hear that, Nick?
Yeah.
And we'll do something big everyone likes next time. We'll talk about fucking Fortnite or Roblox or some shit.
Donald Navity gave us $50. What are you complaining about?
Yeah, exactly. Donald liked this one. We all got to talk about Wojtek the Bear. I like how I'm yelling at Nick. Nick didn't say a single word. Nick was totally fine with this topic.
We,
so
we just assume he'd be fine. Nick says, okay, next week is why Halo is the best. Well, how about you guest star on that alongside the other guest star yourself? And then the two of us can have a break that morning.
That sounds nice. Yeah, just mirror image. You just talking to yourself.
Yeah.
That sounds great.
I think Halo is good. I agree. You're very insightful, self. Well, I guess that'll be it from us. What have we got coming up this week? For in terms of Yahtzee content, we have my usual zero punctuation, which you'll want to stick around for on Wednesday because it's Hogwarts Legacy. So I'm sure that won't be. I'm sure that won't be a shitstorm, and we'll be streaming that at the usual time of 1 p.m. Pacific. I think Nick will be is joining me for that one because everyone else chickened out. And I've got a new extra punctuation dropping for our beloved YouTube members and Patreon subscribers on Thursday.
Ooh. Any hints what it's about?
It will be addressing, amongst other things, Hi-Fi Rush and the upcoming Suicide Squad game. See if you can think what possible topic could connect to those two.
Hey, developers, please just let your fucking games end.
Yeah.
There you go.
There you go.
Perfect. Yeah, in terms of other stuff. Oh, if you guys missed it, you should watch last Friday's Adventure is Live. Took a little bit to get going. There were some technical issues, but you guys had a really great kind of post-mort on season two, as well as there's a little bit of playing going on.
Yeah, we had to have a sort of impromptu session because
Yeah.
Jesse dropped a big story bomb that might have meant Jack would have to throw out a bunch of his what he'd been planning for season three. But we straightened it all out.
There you
and
go.
So essential viewing now for anyone who wants to know how season two will connect to season three.
Exactly. So check that out. In terms of other streams this week, later today, tonight, Jesse and Casey will be back with more Hidden Gems. They're doing Wanted Dead again. Casey's got Wanted Dead fever.
I
think it's beautiful. I think it is absolutely beautiful as the world's number one Wanted Dead influencer. Tomorrow we'll have the recap, and Nick will have Editor's Hour, and then all the streams all this week. Thursday we'll be starting Nick's Xbox 360 journey, I believe, starting with Max Payne 3, which I'm excited for because I haven't played since it came out.
Are we doing Sea of Thieves again on Thursday?
I believe so. I think we have one or two episodes left. This might be the eighth episode.
Okay, just two more episodes.
Two more episodes.
Tune in for more nautical pissing about for the next 2 weeks.
Yeah, so it'll be great. Yeah, and then check out everything on the website. Go to the website. Oh my God, we got so many good words. People are writing amazing words on things.
The written kind of word, no less.
Yeah. It's like videos for your eyes. Those are just videos.
Except videos are for your eyes.
Videos are for your eyes. Yeah.
You adult.
Classic. We got two more super chats while we were goofing.
Oh, good. Ah, Ludwig Williams is all healed up from the earlier burns I administered.
Welcome back, Ludwig.
And gives another $1.99 to say, have you read Bronze Age Mindsets?
What is that?
I found it most stimulating.
You didn't say that. You put words into his mouth.
No, I put an extra nerdy sentence on to his very nerdy super chats.
It's so hard to just see what the fuck a book is about. Oh, I somehow went to Bronze Age pervert. Oh wait, is a student a far right internet personality? What is happening?
I think we'd better move on.
But no, this is what Bronze Age mindset is.
We don't want anything to do with far right internet personalities. Thank you very much.
No, I'm getting out of here. I'm getting out. Chewy, get us out of here.
Drunken Chrono gives $5 and says, "I'm Alexander the Great." Well, thanks for sharing that, Drunken Chrono. Perhaps you might want to sober up and think about your life.
Was it like the Chrono from Chrono Trigger? Who's supposed to be drunk?
I thought there was an H in that.
No, there's an H in the title of the game, but the character's name is Chrono, which is fucking insane. Which is just insane. Like, what are we doing with this?
Well, I guess that'll be it from us then. That's all the Super Chats. That's all the upcoming shit you can look forward to in this week on The Escapist.
We did it!
So we'll just say bye then. Bye then. Toffee wanted to shake himself into view again. Say bye-bye, Toffee. Bye-bye, everybody. Bye-bye.